Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Selamat malam
Waalaikumsalam.
semuanya. Good night everyone. I will
Nah.
try moderation in bilingual themes in Indonesian and English so that it will be easier for you to understand. Jadi saya akan memoderasi ini dalam dua bahasa sekalian simultaneously. Nanti untuk yang speech-nya Tom, akan saya simpulkan di akhir saja. Jadi Bapak-Ibu jangan khawatir, nanti bisa dilihat rekaman dari Tom dan di channel RJI setelah acara ini selesai. Tapi yang kami upload di YouTube hanya speech-nya Tom dan mulai dari pembukaan sampai dengan speech-nya Tom saja. Nanti ketika event bedah jurnal, kita tidak akan upload di YouTube. Gitu ya Bapak-Ibu. Okay, first of all, I would like to say thank you for Bapak Ketut Sudarsana for having you here, and you will have your first speech later. I also would like to thank to how I haven't checked my dictionary how to spell it because it's a Dutch language. Tom Oilik or I don't know, you can pronounce this better later. Tom, please, I send my apologies to you. Tom is the editor-in-chief of the OIJ. And for today's event, this is the first series of our 5 series in RJI OIJ workshop series. So, untuk Bapak-Ibu semuanya yang barusan bergabung, saya sekali lagi mau mengingatkan bahwa event hari ini adalah seri pertama dari 5 seri yang akan kita selenggarakan mulai dari 18 Juli sampai dengan 25 Agustus. Jadi Bapak-Ibu, setiap kali acara harus registrasi, jangan bosan, karena di setiap acara materinya akan berbeda, tapi di setelah setiap materi itu kemudian ada bedah jurnal. So, every each series we have different material, and after that material already presented by the OIJ ambassadors or the OIJ editor-in-chief or editors, after that we will have assessment for journals that being the participants here. So thank you also for everyone here. This is a Saturday night that really meaningful for us to have you here. I know that you have a family agenda or schedule, but you're here to learn about copyright, something that is unusual to discuss in this Saturday night. Okay, to make it short, I would like to invite Bapak Ketut Sudarsana to have the opening speech. Pak Ketut Sudarsana, silakan untuk memulai opening pembukanya, Bapak.
Ya, terima kasih, Mbak Lydia. Suara saya jelas ya?
Jelas, jelas ya. Sekali.
Selamat malam, Bapak Ibu sekalian. Perkenankan saya, Ki Ketut Sudarsana, selaku Wakil Ketua 1 Pengurus Pusat Relawan Jurnal Indonesia, ingin menyampaikan sepatah dua patah kata mengawali acara workshop RJI The Wajib Series pertama ini. The Honorable Mr. Tom, thank you for taking the time to join us. Para pengurus RJI, baik pusat maupun daerah, para pemateri malam ini yang tentunya sudah tidak asing lagi bagi para pengelola jurnal di seluruh Indonesia, para peserta sekalian yang saya muliakan. Berbahagia sekali pada malam yang baik dan indah ini kita bisa bertemu dan bersama-sama belajar mengenai indeksasi DOAJ. Jadi DOAJ, Directory of Open Access Journal, merupakan directory online yang mengindeks dan menyediakan akses jurnal yang open access tentunya. Indeksasi jurnal elektronik ke DOAJ membuat visibilitas jurnal dan artikel yang terbit menjadi lebih luas, dalam hal ini adalah diseminasinya dan tentu berpotensi untuk disitasi oleh para penulis di seluruh dunia. Selain itu, indeksasi kedua menjadikan jurnal kita diakui paling tidak sebagai jurnal berkualitas, menjadikan jurnal kita berada pada pengindeks menengah sesuai dengan aturan akreditasi jurnal nasional. Bapak Ibu sekalian, ada beberapa prinsip transparansi yang harus kita penuhi dalam mengelola jurnal. Prinsip-prinsip tersebut mungkin seperti peer review proses. Jadi naskah sebelum diterbitkan apakah dilakukan review atau tidak. Kemudian ada scope jurnal dan kesesuaian kualifikasi tim editor. Nama, afiliasi tim editor harus jelas. Kemudian autopsi, copyright dengan lisensi informasi dan artikel yang terbit harus jelas. Kemudian ada etika publikasi, informasi publisher dan kontaknya. Kemudian ada website, dalam hal ini adalah tampilan dan informasi jurnal yang lengkap dan konsisten tentunya. Kemudian penamaan jurnal, ini harus disesuaikan dengan ISSN. Kemudian kebijakan jurnal tentang conflict of interest antara penulis, reviewer, kemudian ada editor. Kemudian harus open access tentunya. Kemudian jadwal dan periode publikasi dan arsiping. Jadi Bapak Ibu sekalian, untuk lebih lanjut tentu para pemateri akan mengulas secara keseluruhan, baik dalam aspek persiapan menuju DOAJ, kemudian ada submit ke DOAJ, dan sampai pada kewajiban pasca terindeks DOAJ. Karena ketika jurnal kita sudah dianggap terindeks DOAJ, dimasukkan DOAJ, jadi tentu ada kewajiban kita untuk melakukan submit artikel kita ke DOAJ. Nah, itu mungkin akan diulas tuntas oleh para pemateri pada malam hari ini dan kemudian pada sesi-sesi berikutnya. Jadi melalui kegiatan ini, kami ingin meneguhkan secara umum bahwa tujuan RCI adalah organisasi nirlaba yang memberikan sumbangsih pemikiran dan tenaga untuk pengembangan publikasi di Indonesia pada khususnya dan dunia pada umumnya. Jadi Bapak Ibu sekalian, mungkin saya tidak akan berlama-lama untuk menyita waktu ini karena nanti ada Mr. Tom, kemudian para pemateri yang akan mengulas tuntas mengenai DOAJ ini. Jadi saya kira saya tidak akan berlama-lama. Demikian yang dapat saya sampaikan mewakili Pengurus Pusat Relawan Jurnal Indonesia. Semoga acara hari ini, malam ini, kemudian seri-seri selanjutnya bermanfaat bagi kita bersama untuk kemajuan publikasi di Indonesia. Terima kasih. Jadi waktu saya kembalikan kembali.
Baik, terima kasih Pak Ketut atas sambutannya yang cukup singkat. Okay, thank you for the opening speech. Bapak Ketut sudah sana. I just want to conclude and highlight some things that FGI, our Indonesian Volunteer Journals Organization, is a non-profit organization. We have this very big sameness with DOAJ actually. Okay, let's move on to the next agenda. We don't have to wait for long. I will invite Tom to have the presentations about the copyright issues. Hi, Tom.
Hi. Thank you for inviting me. And I have done quite a few of this kind of presentations in Indonesia already, but I'm happy to explain the most important, most difficult things to you, which poses many problems for many of the editors and people who want to have journals, open access journals in Indonesia. So let me just give one slide. I mean, you will have the slide afterwards. This is a slide where you find the links for the criteria for the quality of journals. So DOAJ has a set of criteria which you are aware of. You very much know about what it is. But there is other indexing services which also index open access journals and subscription journals, Scopus, Web of Science, and KBELS. And if you want, you have the time, you can go into these links and find out about the exact criteria for being indexed in one of those services. So either Scopus, Web of Science, KBELS, or the DOAJ. Of course, there is a big difference for DOAJ. The DOAJ criteria for the quality of journals, we only look at open access journals. We don't have non-open access journals. We look using the principles of best practice. And we don't look very, very much at the scientific quality of the articles, because the scientific quality of the articles is a very specialist job. So we can, of course, personally have an impression of how good an article is, how good the science is, but it's not very right. It's not very fair to do it like that. So we say we have to look at the quality of the business of publishing. How are things published? How good is the editorial board? Are all the procedures of best practice in scholarly publishing followed? And one thing especially is important, it's the quality of open access. And the quality of open access depends on the accessibility. Can you access the website so that you can find your information? But also, what can you do with the information of scientific articles that you find? And therefore, it's very important to know the copyright that is with this article, and also licensing rights. The licensing rights are the rights for the users. What are they allowed to do officially, legally? If you don't have any copyright and you don't have any licensing right, then it's just as if you go out somewhere, you find something and nobody is around, so you say, oh, it's mine. It's not a good way of handling scientific information. You have to know what you can do with it. It shouldn't be just on the internet for everyone to find. It should also be legally cleared who has the copyright, who has the licensing right. And I will talk most of this talk about copyright licensing. One important thing is also that we don't rank journals. You are all familiar with ranking. You know, Scopus is ranking journals. You have SciMago. You have the best journal in psychology, the best journal in theology, in Islamic sciences. You can probably find the best journal of anything. But we don't believe in ranking, because we think that any way that you are ranking journals is promoting competition much more than sharing and helping people, each other, and working together to a common goal. So we don't want to promote competition in a sense, the unhealthy competition. There must be a bit of competition, but not this one, which is just who is the best. So we have a program in Indonesia, you're well aware. We have Dian, we have Ikhwan, we have Muhammad, Tanzil. They are our ambassadors, and the ambassadors are the people who have the most knowledge about DOAJ, about the changes in DOAJ once they are there, who can also be an ambassador for Indonesian people wanting to contact DOAJ on certain subjects, who can also talk to government and official people. So they have a quite important role for us as intermediates. And we have two honorary ambassadors who are also marked here. So what is the position of Indonesia? How good are the journals? Well, I can tell you there is a lot of good journals, but there is also quite a few that don't make it. So you first, Indonesia has a first rank in the journals that we add. Like you can see, over 2,000 journals added in our database of 15,000 journals. But there are also over 2,000 that didn't make it were rejected. So there is some work to be done for people to understand what qualities should they deliver. So if you want to be listed in DOJ, and I will come to this copyright issue very soon now, I will just do some general recommendations. Say the unrestricted copyright for the author is very important. And require it, but we recommend it. Huh? Let's be certain about that. No exclusive publishing rights for the journal, because exclusive rights means that it is not open access, because open access means that everybody can use it or publish it. No transfer of commercial rights. Commercial rights is part of copyright, and it's also something that we don't like to see happening, and we recommend no transfer of commercial rights. We recommend the use of Creative Commons licensing because it's very well described what a user can do with the works. And we also recommend that this copyright, this licensing information is provided with the articles, because sometimes you have journals and it says in the homepage, this journal is open access, there's a license. And then you go to the articles and there's nothing. You cannot even see if it's open access. And so be clear, let's be transparent. And if people just get an article from a colleague and the article itself has nothing on it, then it's not a very good way of handling open access. And then we think it's very useful to have permanent article identifiers. And we don't see that you have to use impact factors, because impact factors also are not very well based scientifically. There is no real reason that the journal is much better or articles are better in the journal. And they just promote the business of the people who make very high impact factors for the journals. So it's not a real good way for open access to advance. And one important thing, which is not a recommendation, it's just the truth. You can never have in your journals, open access journals, all rights reserved, because all rights reserved is completely different from open access. So what are the problems with DOJ criteria which you confront if you are an editor in Indonesia? You have the copyright and licensing issues, which I will talk about after this slide. You have website security sometimes. People have malware installed because their websites are not very secure, which is a reason for DOJ to reject the journal if your website is not safe. The links that you provide are sometimes not to the correct information. So either the information is not there or is not findable very well, which is also a reason for rejection. The peer reviewer diversity, and with that I will say, if you have peer review people from one in the same university or department, everybody knows each other, then it is not really, really independent peer reviewing. So you have to take care of having a diverse peer reviewer setting and also editorial board. Then what we often see is APC changes after being listed in the DOJ. Now, it may be that you can increase your APC for 20 or 10%, but we wouldn't want to see a journal that doesn't have any APC, or for example, $100, and then it's in DOJ, and then it is $800, which is not in the interest of people sharing the science and getting anywhere. So we are not saying that we are going to reject the journal when they do it. But I think it's not a very good publishing practice to do. So, why is it not advancing? Yes, it is. Okay. So, the copyright and licensing, if you want to really have some insights in specific examples, then you can go to this this link, Blogs of the DOAJ, where I have described very special cases of copyright and licensing problems. And it's a series of four now, and we may extend it, we may have another follow-up of this. But if you want to recapitulate what I have said here, you can go to this site and see what you to really understand what's going on. So what are the problems? One of the problems that we see in Indonesia, especially, the authors retain the copyright. There is a copyright transfer agreement in place. Is this statement okay? Is the question, and we can answer it afterwards. Do you think this is okay? You see it in journals. Why do you see this in journals? I mean, if you say the authors retain the copyright cannot be transferred because the authors retain the copyright. So if you have a journal and you say authors retain the copyright because you think you have to say that, but you want the copyright for the journal, so you leave that sentence on copyright transfer agreement, which is often that we see that, huh? Then it's not okay. This is an issue that we encounter very much. So the next one. So this is an example. The next one is the open access license is there, but in all the articles that you can find in the journal, you see all rights reserved. And all rights reserved means that there cannot be an open access license. So I will just say, what is the copyright? The copyright is a part of the intellectual property right. It means that you have your property. And intellectual property rights has the copyright and has also patenting rights and also has invention rights and things like that. So it's a bit broader. Intellectual property right is broader than copyright. We're talking about copyright here, but if you say all rights reserved, then the copyright may be anywhere, but the license cannot be given, because all rights are reserved. So the example is from an Indonesian journal here. Then there is the possibility, what we have seen in Indonesian journals, you have an open access license like CC BY SA, but in the text, either only the text of the Indonesian Sabda Bahasa text or the English text as well, it says that the publisher restricts the rights of the authors to fair use only. And that means that that it's not okay, because an open access license for users means that all the users, including the author, are allowed to use the works in a certain way. So a publisher can never give an open access license to an article or to a work and then restrict the right of the author to just being able to use it in the classroom or in a personal website or something like that, which is fair use. So you have to understand that an open access license is not compatible with restricting the rights of a single group of users, which is the authors. The authors are also users. So here is a similar case of rights restricted for educational purposes only, which is most of the time in many countries, this means fair use. And there is the pertinent use of the CC BY NC license. Now, you cannot have this license and then say that the rights are only for using articles for educational purposes. That is not possible. And they don't talk about the authors here. Huh? So this is also not a combination that goes. Open access license means that the work can just be used for any purpose, for copying it, for giving it to your friends or colleagues, and sharing it with other people to work on it, except in this license for commercial use. There you can say, okay, you cannot use it commercially, you cannot take this article and go to an editor, make it in a book, and then sell that for a price. That is not possible. But you cannot have the combination of open access license by a publisher, and then the same publisher says the rights are restricted for educational purposes only. That is not possible. Here is also an example. It's all real life examples. Copyright is transferred to the journal. There is a CC BY SA license. And there are exclusive rights for the publisher. That is not possible because CC BY SA means that anybody can use the article for whatever purpose, even commercially. And if the publisher says in the same journal page, we need the exclusive rights, then nobody can use that article for anything. Because exclusive rights means that the article can only be used by the publisher for whatever use they want. And that is not okay, because it's an open access license. So you cannot have this combination either. As a last thing, I think it's rather important to address this as well. There is always the question of how do we get predatory journals out of the OAJ? So that is very important. For the first thing to say is that there is a difference between predatory and low quality journals. And especially in Indonesia, there is quite a good journals, many, but there is also low quality journals who are just not up to the standards of real good publishing. And we are not going to say that those are predatory because they're just not good enough. Predatory means something else. Predatory means that these publishers are really on purpose not doing the things they should do to publish. And that they don't deliver the right content, they don't deliver services, they are not transparent about any costs or their address or where they're based or where they work from. And in general, the business behavior can be rather shady. That is the journals that we don't accept at all. Then there are the low quality publishers, and that often is due to inadequate peer review. Or that, for example, the editors and peer reviewers are from one institute only, what I have told you about in the beginning of this talk. And that is a journal that might be accepted in DOJ if it's not too low a quality. But if there is inadequate peer review, then it will not be accepted. So the low quality, we are going in a bit more in the detail of the scientific quality as well. And a special team of our organization reviews these suspicious journal applications from all over the world with a very defined set of criteria, which are separate from the criteria for indexation in DOJ. These are not public, so we are not giving out a list of this is all the criteria for predatory publishers, because that would make it very easy for them to mask their behavior and to try and get into very good indexes. But they are similar to the set of criteria that Kay Belz has published, and that is in the link in the other slide, looking at editorial board, looking at basis of the publisher, business behavior, quality of the content, fake matrix, mail spamming often. So you can find out what these journals have, and you should just try to steer clear from them. And we don't have them in our database. Well, the good news is that Indonesia doesn't have many questionable journals, but more of low quality publishing and not a very good understanding of copyright and licensing. So there is a need for a repeated education. I have been giving some of these talks in Indonesia in certain workshops, but I think it's very good if this subject of good publishing practices and copyright and licensing issues can be repeated as often as possible for people who haven't been able to see this presentation or to know about where to find the information. I think it's very useful to get as much information in the DOJ site in Indonesian, and we are very much into translating our website content and all our information in many languages. Indonesian is certainly one of the most important ones because there are so many journals that we have in our database. But we also have French and Spanish and Italian. And although everybody knows English, it's much, much more easy for all of us to just use our own language to understand better what you need to do, what is being said. And that's why we think we are going to really emphasize the local language, the language of the people wanting to learn about open access. So, perhaps the last word is that the copyright for the author and the copyright for the journal is both okay for DOJ. We recommend copyright for the author because then the author has all the rights for himself and can determine what happens. And you see often that people say, okay, the copyright is for the author, but they still want the copyright for the journal because it's the tradition that journals have the copyright. And then they just write in the website, copyright for the author, and leave the sentence, transfer copyright to the publisher, which is what we don't accept, of course. But either one, or the copyright is for the author, or there is a transfer to the publisher, is both okay for an open access journal, as long as all the articles are published open access, using a license, an open access license. So I hope that things has become a bit more clear for you. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Tom, for your brief explanation about the copyright issues. And you exactly captured so many, there are several problems usually happen for journal in Indonesia. I really appreciate that. We have those issues here and there, and I agree that we have to amplify the education to everyone, especially for journal managers in Indonesia to have this DOIJ as their index in their journals.
I think you have to take care that, for example, many of these problems exist because editors of journals are copying sentences from other journals. So the other journal that has been accepted in DOIJ says that the copyright has been transferred. And then exactly that same thing should be okay, people think. And then you do it in your other, your journal information. But you don't understand that perhaps the conditions for your journal are different from the other. So you really have to take care that either you have the copyright as a publisher or the author, and there shouldn't be both. It cannot be shared copyright or anything like that. That is not possible. And it should certainly never be, like I said, all rights reserved. When we see all rights reserved in a journal article, then it will be automatically rejection for that journal. And they have to wait another 6 months and see what they can repair, because that is not possible. The all rights reserved may just be used for the look of the website, for example. You can say our website is copyright by the journal publisher, and all rights of the website look is these kind of things are just all rights reserved, but not the content of the articles.
Thank you for the explanation. Jadi, I will say it in Indonesia briefly. Your last several sentences. Jadi Bapak Ibu yang mungkin harus saya ulang yang terakhir tadi yang tidak ada slide-nya adalah kalau mau mencontoh jurnal, ketika copy paste about jurnal dari yang sebelum yang sudah terindeks, dan ternyata banyak dari teman-teman dari editor yang kemudian sudah merubah yang tadinya open access menjadi all rights reserved. Dan ketika perubahan itu Bapak contoh atau Bapak Ibu contoh, akhirnya rejected. Jadi hati-hati ketika kita meneladani, ya, saya bahasakan meneladani mungkin ya lebih oke daripada mencontoh. Meneladani jurnal yang sudah terindeks, jadi dibaca baik-baik dulu, kalau perlu ditranslasi dulu, dicek. Jangan sampai itu yang menjadi hal yang menjadi rejections. Begitu. Jadi hal-hal yang lain yang mungkin saya tidak saya akan menyimpulkan sedikit sebenarnya. Jadi ada beberapa permasalahan pada copyrighted itu adalah karena kalau sudah ada kalimat yang menyatakan bahwa copyright transfer, itu nanti akan dibahas juga oleh teman-teman AE nanti setelah ini, dibahas lebih panjang karena sudah ada ahlinya di sini. Tapi di sini yang perlu saya ini mungkin simpulkan, mungkin perbedaan definisi DOIJ atas predatory journal atau predatory publishers. Jadi standarnya itu yang diperhatikan adalah kontennya, layanannya, transparansi. Berarti kalimat-kalimat ini harus ada di dalam definisi Bapak Ibu di about journal, ya, dan business behavior termasuk APJ dan sebagainya. Nanti akan dibahas lebih jauh nih nanti. Saya rasa saya minta izin dulu ke Tom, apakah bisa kita ada pertanyaan. I'm sorry, Tom, can we have several questions for discussions?
Yes, of course.
Okay, Bapak Ibu silakan yang mau bertanya bisa raise hand atau melalui chat. Nanti ya, bahasa Indonesia tidak apa-apa, nanti akan saya bantu untuk mentranslasi. Karena tadi while you are presenting just now, I have already disabled the chat, so probably our audience have several questions about this copyright issues. Bapak Ibu silakan, ada yang mau bertanya? Kalau tidak ada, nanti saya yang akan bertanya. Actually, I have my own question, Tom. Could you please Allow me to ask you about the let me see my question. Your special team at the OIG reviews the suspicious journal applications. This set of the internal criteria, could you mention more detail what are these internal criteria?
So the internal criteria that we use have to do with the publishing practice, so good publishing practice. And we think it is not a good publishing practice, for example, if the editorial board members are mentioned in the website, and if you go and look up the names of the editorial board, you cannot find those people because they are never in the internet anywhere. So either these are fake persons or you don't know where they work. We need to have editorial board members with their affiliation. And not many people make this mistake. Eh? But in some of the predatory journals, there is just a list of names of people. And then as long as a professor, and they don't say where, then they think it will be okay. But of course it's not okay. And that is one of the easy things. And another thing may be that a journal is based, for example, in Indonesia. But if you then look up the address of the of where the website is, then the website is in the United States. And the address may be just in the United States. So sometimes these predatory publishers, they want an address that looks very flashy. Something like an address in the United States, people think, oh, it's from the United States, must be a good journal. And this reasoning, of course, you can understand. But it's very easy to see if a journal is from India and then the address that they give is in the United States. There is something fishy. It's something that doesn't ring a bell for the good tune. So that is things. But if you really want to go into the how can you detect predatory publishers, that is just an issue that is very difficult because there are so many tricks that publishers can use. You know, there is also web shops that sell very nice stuff, you think, and then when you get it at home, it's not nice at all. So there is many tricks that people can use. They just make themselves look very well dressed, also as a journal, and they are not very good journals. So the best list, and I'm not promoting K-Belt in any way, but it's a very extensive list of journal criteria for predatory behavior. And you can just look up that reference that I gave in my slide on the K-Bell predatory criteria. It's a good guideline. But I personally think that none of the researchers should have to bother with predatory journals, because if you want to publish open access, publish in a journal that is listed in the DOJ, then we have done the work for you, because we don't have predatory journals. And if you want to publish in a journal that we don't list, then try and find out if any of your colleagues has good experiences with that journal, if it's a good journal by hearsay from as many people that you know. So be very careful with journals that are not in DOJ. So yeah, that is what I would say.
Yes. So the standard itself is we cannot define it in details, but we can see some of the signs or traces of the fishy things inside the journals. Okay, there are several questions already come into the chat room, and there are so many questions about the 6 months pending that we have to wait after we got rejected. Why it is 6 months? So many viewers here ask,
if you are being rejected, mm-hmm. and then there is a 6 month period.
So how do you define these 6 month periods? I mean, they want to know the reason.
Yeah, the reason is that we get about 600 to 800 applications each month.
Oh, okay.
Without a delay in applications from journals that have been just reviewed, then we would have so high a workload that we couldn't do the work.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's a matter of maintaining the quality of the assessment itself, right?
Yes, okay. And then also giving a reasonable time between mm-hmm. submitting your application and the decision. Because if you have to wait for 1.5 years mm-hmm. after submitting, that is not good. We really want to have like 4 months mm-hmm. between submission and decision, and a maximum of perhaps 5-6 months in certain cases, but it shouldn't be longer. And we have to just tell people who have been rejected, 6 months is a reasonable time for us to just do the other applications that are there. Mm-hmm. And 6 months is often also very necessary for the journals that are being rejected mm-hmm. to address the problems that they have, to make things right. That is also not done in a few weeks.
Okay, jadi Bapak Ibu alasannya 6 bulan itu karena ada banyak sekali jurnal, ribuan jurnal yang harus di-assess. Jadi untuk membuat kualitas assessment itu sendiri baik, jadi butuh proses 6 bulan karena biasanya juga jurnal di Indonesia itu publish-nya juga tentang waktunya ada yang biannually kan, 1 tahun 2 kali itu. Mungkin itu waktu yang reasonable menurut Tom demikian. Like, and the next question is about the percentage of the author, the percentage of the editor that wants to write in their own journal. Do the OIJ have exact numbers of percentage that if, for example, like me, I'm the editor of a journal and I want to write in my own journal, how the percentage of the OIJ reasonable percentage that acceptable for the OIJ?
There is nothing wrong with publishing in your own journal, but we do look at who is publishing in your journal. So if all the articles, or perhaps 4 out of 5 articles in your journal are written by editors of the journal, that is not acceptable. Hmm. But if you want to publish your work in your journal, mm-hmm. and for example, you publish 200 articles a year, and there is something like 10 articles of the 200 articles is from editors from that journal, there is nothing wrong with that. As long as there is a peer review that is by independent reviewers, and of course, the editors that take the decision on acceptance of that article should be other editors than you yourself.
Okay, jadi Bapak-Ibu, tidak ada persentase yang pasti ya, tapi reasonable-nya, tadi contohnya 200, kalau misalnya publish 200, kalau 10 aja dari editornya nggak apa-apa. Jadi silakan dimatematikakan sendiri, kalau kita 10 berarti maksimalnya berapa. Okay, Tom, it's actually already 3 questions, and the other questions will answer by the associate editors later because it's more like the technical problem. I really mm-hmm. have to say thank you for your presentations today. It's really enlightening, and it brings so many new point of view for copyright issues, especially for journals in Indonesia that wants to index by the ORG. Thank you, Tom. Have a nice day.
I will send the presentation to Ikhwan.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so that he can share it in case anybody just wants to see it again.
Okay.
But you have also have the recording, of course. But I mean,
yeah,
you can send the PowerPoint link.
Okay.
To Ikhwan, so that you can also see the presentation slides again for yourself.
Okay, thank you. Yep. And we will upload it in Zenodo in our self-archivings. So the viewers and the audience
If you have any specific questions that I didn't address, write us, and then we will try to answer your questions.
Okay. Thank you, Tom.
Thank you.
Any more closing statement for the viewers here in this afternoon?
No, I think.
Okay, thank you, Tom.
I just thank you for being so interested in this topic. It's very difficult. I know the open access and copyright and licensing is what many people don't understand, all the specifics about that. And even our editors all over the world always have enough questions again about this topic, because there is so much complexity that you will always find an example that has not been described, so that you don't know what to do. You have to think about it. So if you have any problems with copyright that you can't solve with the things that I explained to you, please write us or ask Ikhwan, and Ikhwan will contact us, and then we will know more about what happens in the field, because that is important for us.
Yeah,
thank you for being there and taking your time to listen to me.
Yeah, it's a very pleasure for us to listen to you directly from the editor-in-chief of the ORG. So we know exactly that the information is very clear and confirmed. And we just have to remind our colleagues and friends to always take attention to the copyright issues in their own journal, especially. Thank you, Tom. We move on to the next sessions.
If we have the question, we can make a letter for the.
Could you please raise your hand first? There is someone who wants to talk to you, Tom. Would you like to have her talk to you directly? I think she has a question to you.
Yes,
silakan Ibu, yang mau tanya.
Yeah, if we have the problem about our journal, because we have two times applied to the DOAZ, but until now we didn't always rejection from the DOAZ. If we have the problem, can ask from your email.
Mm-hmm.
We can letter to your emails, right?
Okay. We can. I mean, but we have Ikhwan,
as an
ambassador, an editor, and if you want to have specific answers, then you can also. He will just give this question to me.
Okay.
So we want it to go through Ikhwan or to the managing editor, who is Lina Shah. But Ikhwan knows the addresses and how to contact us.
Okay.
We will give you information. We are not in the business of just rejecting journals. If there is anything that you think, why are we being rejected for the second time and we did our best and we can explain it better, then we will. Mm-hmm. We will explain it better.
Okay, thank you so much. Yeah. You can explain about why we rejection?
Thank you. Nanti bisa, maksudnya Tom tadi, Ibu bisa kontak Pak Ikhwan sebagai ambasador Indonesia. Tadi ada tiga, Budian atau Bapak Tansil Mutazam. Tapi ada di seri kelima dan ketiga nanti Pak Ivan jadi narasumber. Okay, Tom, we will have also Ivan Arif as the keynote speakers later on the third session, if I'm not mistaken. The second or the third. And then also Muhammad Tansil Muntazam are the last of our series will be the keynote speakers like you today. Thank you for...
Thank you very much. And have a very nice weekend.
Yeah, you too. You can leave the room or you can still hear. It's all your call. And I will continue all the session in Indonesian mode.
Yes, okay. Well, thanks. Goodbye.
Okay. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.